All right, now let's look at chapter 3. After Paul has largely defamed and demoralized these Jews for their arrogance, he then moves back and tries to put it into perspective. Because remember, he's not against the fact that Jews have a wonderful heritage, an association with the covenant with Abraham, that Jews do have privilege and benefits. He just wants to be sure that there is a proper emphasis, the cart before the horse, as I mentioned earlier. Now, what we see in chapter 3, we're also going to see once again, and it's important to recognize this, when you get into chapter 9, Paul says very close to the same kind of thing. And I was looking in my files and I couldn't find it because it's been probably 20 years since I've seen it. But somewhere in my files I have sort of like a diagram that a person did, an outline, but a special kind of outline, in which he graphed chapter 3 and chapter 9 and moved it backwards. These actually have a relationship of like A, B, B, A kind of poetical structure. But I couldn't find it to show it to you, so we'll just have to wait till next time. But he says, what advantage then has the Jew, or what is the profit of circumcision? Well, see, when he makes that statement, the anticipated response of the Gentile is none whatsoever. If he's just got through saying that circumcision in the flesh is irrelevant, it's circumcision of the heart that's important. See, he just got through saying all of that, then you expect him to say, what advantage then has a Jew, or what is the profit of circumcision? None. But his response is, much in every way. What an unusual comeback. Now the Gentile, who was just getting ready, loaded for bear, and he says, yay, Paul, get him, Paul, get him, Paul. You know. And they're saying, what profit? None whatsoever, they think Paul's going to say. Then he says, much in every way. That is, the external circumcision is helpful and valuable. Chiefly because to them were committed the oracles of God. For what if some did not believe? Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? Certainly not. Indeed, let God be true, but every man a liar. So, in looking at this, were there Jews that did not follow through appropriately? They were circumcised in the flesh, but they never seemed to get circumcised in the heart. There were, right? But that doesn't invalidate the fact that God had wanted them to obey the law and to be circumcised. Their lack of obedience did not invalidate the commandments and desires of God. Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? Now that's how the New King James does it. Literally, the concept is the word katergeo, which, by the way, is the word used in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 four different times, interestingly enough, about what prophecies will fail, you know, knowledge will fail, when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part will fail, or be stopped. It's the same Greek word. The point is, will the unfaithfulness of these Jews who failed to put into proper perspective inward reality and outward reality, this failure of their part, does that unbelief then cause the faithfulness of God to come to naught, to fail? Again, the term. Then Paul says something, and I can't say it, my Greek professor once upon a time gave us a very interesting translation of this, but I won't give it to you. But it's really not God forbid, although that's a nice term. It's me gnoita. It's a very strong statement of may it never be. Philip's paraphrase of the New Testament when it comes across me genoita. I'll give this to you here. In Greek, it's me genoita. Me genoita. May it never be. Philip's paraphrase says, what a ghastly thought. In other words, you're to open your mouth in a sense of disbelief. Does the fact that some did not believe cause God's faithfulness to His people and His covenant? Did it make it no longer enforceable? May it never be. Rather, let God be true and every man a liar. Just as is written, that you may be justified in your words and may be a victor in your judgments. Now, I was looking at the New King James, who said may overcome. The word here for overcome is in Greek the word Nike. Sounds like a tennis shoe. But the word Nike actually is a word which means victory. So remember, it says, will the unfaithfulness of the Jews that did not properly get this cart and horse problem put together so that they not only fulfilled the external but also the internal, will this unfaithfulness cause God's faithfulness to fail? And he says, may it never be. Let God be true, may every man be a liar. And then Paul says, here's the proof that he would be justified in his words. God's, what he says is true. And may he be a victor in his judgments. And that's what Paul quotes. That's from Psalm 116:11. And also from Psalm 51:4. Now, those are the two passages that comes from. Now, let me put some perspective to this. If you want to go back to the book of Genesis, we're going to look at Genesis a moment. Now, I realize I'm coming from a particular theological position. I do so because I think it's the biblical position. I think that it is important that we follow a genuine method of biblical interpretation. What I consider genuine is called literal, grammatical, historical interpretation. I do not want to abide or adopt the kind of interpretive viewpoints that were pushed by people like Origen, Kilman of Alexandria, and others, even to the medieval period, who found every kind of meaning possible besides the meaning the text was talking about. They had very fanciful, I mean, they should have been science fiction writers, because they came up with ideas the text was not speaking to at all. There will be people, by the way, who say, well, in the book of Revelation, you know, the word thousand, well, he couldn't mean the thousand. Thousand is symbolical. So every time they see a symbol like seven or four or two, well, those are all symbols. Really? So when it talks about two witnesses, that's talking about what? Right? And when it talks about a city that sits on seven hills, that seven must not be talking about a city on really seven hills. There is a city with seven hills. Sure, there's symbolism, but symbolism is mixed up in literal views, and everybody understands that. In the hymnic literature, when the Psalms, for example, when you have the psalmist talking, oftentimes he will use figures, but he uses figures in the midst of literal language. See, figures are not in antithetical literal. There's two kinds of literal. There's literal that is what we might call plain meaning, and there's literal that we would call figurative. What you're getting here is to a literal truth. that can be expressed in figurative ways. And the psalmist does that, as does John and others. Literal, grammatical, historical. Very important to pick up. I have no problem adopting numbers and recognizing their figures in the midst of them. We do that all the time. Matter of fact, for example, I remember reading a poem years ago in college about an eagle. And it talked about he clutched the crags of the rock with his hands. Well, first of all, we don't normally think of eagles having hands. They're claws. But he used a human term about it. Eagle was a literal, and I think eagle stood for something else. Well, the eagle clutched the crags of the rock. That means that power holds on to stability with tenacity or something or another. I mean, you know, it's the poet's seeing a real eagle, and he's using a figure in the midst of the literal language. He strikes like lightning he doesn't really. Lightning is a lot faster than an eagle. It's a simile. Use similes and metaphors to state literal truth. The Bible does the same thing. So you have to be careful about this. I say this because we're going to see some indications of this later. So it's important now when we look at the Bible passage that we use a solid method of biblical interpretation. Well, let's go back now and look at the book of Genesis just for a few minutes. Put your finger or something in that passage in Romans and go back to Genesis chapter 12. Paul was very familiar with Genesis 12. And we're looking at Genesis 12 and 15 together. We'll start with 12 and then move on to 15. Genesis 12 says, if I ever get to it, "Now Yahweh had said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you, and I make your name great, and you shall be a blessing." Now, first of all, is this some kind of bilateral agreement that God and Abraham made? Actually, all we have here is God telling Abram to do something, and Abraham's performance will certainly indicate whether or not the intention that God had would occur. But we're going to come in a moment to a clear non-bilateral agreement in chapter 15, which is called a unilateral agreement. But then he says, "And I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." Now, I agree that Abram's ultimate fulfillment here is in the Christ. Because in ultimately the Messiah, all the peoples, including us, have been blessed. The issue that I want to deal with here is the fact that I receive this concept of blessing in the covenant mean that I have taken over the whole covenant? We're going to get to Genesis chapter 15, if you'll move there now. "After these things, the word of Yahweh came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram, I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward." What a thing for God to say that I am Abraham's reward. "But Abram said, Lord Yahweh, what will you give me, seeing I go childless and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? Then Abram said, look, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. And behold, the word of Yahweh came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir, that is Eliezer, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Then he brought him outside and said, look, now toward heaven, and count the stars if you're able to number them. And he said to them, so shall your descendants be. And he believed in Yahweh, and he accounted it to him for righteousness," which we will get into in chapter 4 and chapter 5. Then he said to him, I am Yahweh who brought you out of the Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to inherit it. And he said, Lord Yahweh, how shall I know that I will inherit it? So he said to him, bring me a three-year-old heifer, a three-year-old female goat, a three-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. Then he brought all these to him and cut them in two down the middle and placed each piece opposite the other. Now here's what we got. You have these animals. So what they did was take and cut like this. Not in half like this, but down the middle, so that you have two sides of a face on either side and all the way down. Okay? They cut the animals this way. Now, why didn't they cut the turtle dove and the, what's the other one?
Pigeon.
And the pigeon. They didn't cut them down the middle. They weren't on either side. Why would that be, I wonder? They did not have precision instruments here. These are Flintstone knives. You'd rip it to pieces. But essentially, you created this down the middle. Okay? Now, continuing to read. And when the vultures came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. How interesting, how real. You don't find this much in some kind of mythical literature. I mean, this is a down-to-earth real story, see, because he's there, he's cut them in two, and he's waiting around because the sun hasn't gone down yet, and he's got to drive the vultures away. He's got dead animals lying out there. Very true-to-life story, see. Now, when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram. Can you tell me another time a sleep occurred?
Adam.
God brought a sleep on Adam. I think he brought a sleep on Abram. A deep sleep fell on Abram, and behold, horror and great darkness fell upon him. Then he said to Abram, know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years. And also the nation whom they serve, I will judge. You're familiar with this story, aren't you? Egypt. Afterward, they shall come out with great possessions. Now, as for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace. You shall be buried at a good old age. But in the fourth generation, they shall return here, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. And it came to pass, when the sun went down and it was dark, and behold, there appeared a smoking oven and a burning torch that passed between those pieces. Okay, like that. On the same day, Yahweh made a covenant with Abram, saying, to your descendants I have given this land, from the river of Egypt to the great river. What's that? What's the river of Egypt?
The Nile.
The Nile. To the great river, the river Euphrates. The Kenites, the Kenizzites, the Cadmonites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Electricites, the Raphaim, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Girgashites, and the Jebusites. All these sites. So, that's the promise that God made to Abram and his descendants. And notice, the promise was based on a unilateral covenant, not a bilateral. In these days, what the people would do when they made a covenant, the two parties to the covenant would walk between the animals in half. And by walking through the animals, they essentially said this, may it happen to us that has happened to the animals if we violate the covenant. And the word for covenant originally is the word berit, which means to cut. That's what the word means. A covenant is to cut. That's a historic meaning. Since only Yahweh went through, whether or not his covenant to Abraham's descendants, and Abraham and by extension to his descendants, is fulfilled or not depends on Yahweh, not the descendants. See, there are people who say, the people of Israel have no more future since their rejection of Christ. Now the church has become Israel, and Israel is no more, ever again. That means that God has failed. That's what it means. God has failed. Because this covenant's fulfillment is not dependent upon whether the Israelites as a people are faithful. The covenant is dependent upon whether God is faithful. We know the people of Israel have not been faithful. They've gone through several conquerings and several deportations and much sorrow. They have not been faithful. But this is not the question. The question is God faithful? See, this is an unconditional covenant. So I'm always amused. If you want to read on this, you can read my chapter on how the church is appropriating Israel's blessings in my book, Israel, the Land, and the People. I'm not sure my exact title. It's been a long time since I've written it. But it's a fairly lengthy article dealing with the whole question, where did this idea ever come from? We call replacement theology, that the church essentially has become Israel and Israel no longer has a future. Where did that idea come from? Well, there's some reasons for it coming about. But this is an unconditional covenant. And so when Paul says here in chapter 3 of Romans, will their unbelief cause the faithfulness of God to fail? Yea or nay? Paul had the answer. Meganoita, may it never be. What a ghastly thought. Who could think such a thing? And yet there are Christian theologians on a regular basis who do. Who can think such a thing, Paul says. Let God be true and every man, or Christian theologian, a liar. Just as is written, thus is he justified in his words and he is victorious in his judgments. If our unrighteousness, Paul goes on to say in chapter 3, if our unrighteousness somehow is associated with or causes the righteousness of God to stand, what shall we say? If somehow our unrighteousness demonstrates God's righteousness, is God unjust then who inflicts wrath? Paul says, I speak as a man. Interesting expression. Socrates uses the same statement at one point. He says, I speak as a man. What he's getting at is that don't take me too seriously in what I'm saying. I'm speaking sort of out of my mind. It's a method of argumentation. Have you ever heard of the place a person says, I'll concede you that for argument? What do you mean by that?
He doesn't believe it.
Yeah, I don't agree with you, but I don't want to argue that point. I want to argue the other point. I want to get embroiled in that discussion. We'll get to that discussion later. I want to argue this point. I'll concede that for the moment, you know, for the sake of the argument. Yes?
Is Paul that familiar with Socrates, do you
think? Oh, I'm sure he read Socrates, for sure. Everybody in the ancient world who was an educated person would have read the Iliad and the Odyssey, and that's Homer. We would have read the probably Euthyphro, okay, which was Socrates and his taking the poison, and also some of the works of Plato and so forth, and he also would have read the Iliad and the Odyssey. I mean, any educated person would have been familiar with those works. But he says, "I speak as a man." In other words, understand that this is not my viewpoint. You know, so he doesn't want somebody to take him wrong in his understanding. So if our unrighteousness somehow uh, it's hard to know how to translate this particular word, because I was looking at the New King James. They translated it to demonstrates. The word actually is from sunhistemius, the idea makes something to stand together, sort of establishes, maybe it would be a good term. Establishes the righteousness of God. What shall we say? God is not unrighteous. See? God is not unrighteous to bring wrath down. Of course, that's a question mark, it looks like. Is God unrighteous to bring wrath? Certainly not. There you have the word meganoita again. May it never be. For then how will God judge the world? So if our unrighteousness somehow establishes God's righteousness, is God unjust when he gives wrath against us? No, because if that were so, then he would not be just, and so he couldn't judge the world. Paul assumes correctly that Scripture teaches that God will in fact judge the world. So since it's a logical conclusion here. Since God is going to judge the world, he can't be just. He can't be unjust if he's going to judge. So what's going on here must not be an indication of injustice with God. For if the truth of God has increased through my life to his glory, why am I still judged as a sinner? Get this now. By the way, Paul is dealing with arguments that I hear myself today. Well, if God does that, then why am I held accountable? You know, if what I do somehow benefits God, then somehow that can't be true, because then God then would somehow be guilty. Paul deals with that. He says, if the truth of God, that is that he's faithful, even in spite of our unfaithfulness, has increased and made his glory come, why am I judged a sinner? Why? Because I fall short of God's standards. Why not say, let us do evil that good may come? Boy, I've heard these same arguments. I had someone at Summit, we were talking about the idea of election. They said, my goodness, if people really are elect, why even believe? Or if people are really elect, then just do whatever you want to. You're going to go to heaven anyway. Same argument I've talked about, security of the believer. Well, if you really believe a person is secure in Christ so that they in fact will never, ever cease to be secure and will actually go to heaven, if you really believe that, then you can sin all you want, do all you want. The same arguments that I hear today, Paul dealt with. Somebody asked me one time, well, if God has really chosen from all eternity, then why would you ever have anybody condemned? Why don't you just choose everybody? Scripture teaches because it fulfills his glory. It manifests and praises his glory. See, we think the reason why God does everything is because of us. We really do believe that we are the center of the universe. Now, you begin to realize when you have something happen, like, you know, you fall and break your leg, or a disease hits you, and all of a sudden your life is in danger. When difficulties come, you realize that we're not all that important. And the sense that the world can go on without us. If we die, actually, life will go on. History will continue. We have a hard time working through that because we're so absorbed with ourselves. Well, I live with myself 24 hours a day. And because of that, I'm enamored with myself. I mean, I'm pretty important to myself. But in the scheme of things, I'm but a part of the whole. God is ultimate, and all things are for his glory. And we have to get that perspective. You can't understand the book of Romans very well if you really are a self-centered, man-centered person. If you believe theology is a theology of man and not a theology of God, then you'll have difficulty with Romans.